it was the biggest character I've ever met in my entire life. I used to be scared to walk in the pee office sometimes. The owner that reads in there and going to get me. So there'd be things like he taught me what capris were because shorts. He used to say, well, nice capris, and I'd be like, taught me that. He also was the first one to call me Papa Smurf. CeeLo Brown, CeeLo Green. So as you can imagine, it was kind of tough on me in the PE office, that guy, but I'll miss him. He was just a wonderful guy. I mean, he could clown with the best, but at times when we were one-on-one together, he could tell me, he gave me some great suggestions. For example, one time, I was just going to take over for the coaching program, football program, and I was nervous about it, and I wasn't sure about myself, and he's like, hey, Dan, man, don't worry about it. Just be yourself. You're a great guy. You can do it. And, those words were powerful to me, they were really powerful to me, and he's a great guy. That's the kind of guy he was. I mean, throughout this whole thing, you could just tell what a wonderful guy. And, I'm going to miss him to death. I'm going to miss him forever, man. I can't believe he's gone. My mind is going crazy right now with thoughts, but I'll keep this short. It's just, I want you to know, one thing I do want to say, though, is it was so evident. You know, no matter how much he talked to me, he got serious about his family. You could tell he loved his family. His wife and his children, he really loved and cared about, and all through the clowning, he was serious about that, and he was an amazing man, and I'm going to miss him. Thank you.
One of the examples he cited was a universal remote. They don't work. You turn on the TV and then that's all it does. And see, it doesn't turn on the volume. One of the things that's going to really hurt is Neil was universal. Mm-hmm. He 7 years ago, he came here and none of us knew him. And he fit right in. I mean, we knew him through Eris. But, matter of fact, he actually made us know Eris more. And he actually kind of introduced you. So, one of the things that's going to hurt long term, I think, is we're going to be sitting on the sideline and we're going to wonder where the joke's going to come from. Because it always came from him. He just had one. He made us all fit together. Everybody was on one step. It wasn't a basketball staff, it wasn't a football staff, it wasn't track. We were just all one big staff. And one of the most welcome places on this campus was that boys coach's office. So it's going to be a big hole for a long time to come. But just one thing Bob would want everybody to remember was just how much he cracked everybody up. Because he really could. And someday when the statute of limitations goes out, the Neil Reed punking system, the people that were punked will need to be told. But it might be just a little too early yet. Marco Soil.
Here at the school, and He obviously touched the lives of students and coaches. He also meant a lot to us in the office. You can always tell when he was coming. My office is at the end of the building, and I could hear him from way down the hall. He just had the voice that carried and the laughing. And I was blessed to know him, as I know all of us in the office were. And I myself have two girls, and I would ask how his girls are doing, and he would ask how mine are doing, and I would share, and he would listen. He didn't just ask me just to ask. He actually listened when I needed to talk about something, maybe. So I personally am very blessed to have got to work with him, as I know all of you are, and I'm thankful, and God bless the family and your precious babies. Thank you.
Coming in, there was a bunch of kids who needed guidance to look up to ask either complicated questions or a simple one. He would always be giving me lectures because I had a little bit of problems with my freshman year. I still understand things, but every day I would ask how I'm doing, how he could help me out with something. And just overall, Coach Reed was such a positive influence to the community. He has helped out every single kid I probably know, even giving one-on-one advice or just talking to an entire class. As I became a senior, not only he like saw me, watched me grow as an athlete, but also into a young man. Asking me how I was doing and keeping up with me. But I just remember his positive attitude, always smiling, just outgoing. I looked up to that. And I tried to become like Mr. Reed every day. And about a week ago, I was just at Home Waters. And I saw someone sitting down. He's a tall guy. He had a Subway sandwich in his hand, waiting for his car. I saw Mr. Reed, he stood there, like, hey, Pompey, how you doing? Babe, we all love you, Mr. Reed, and we'll miss you.
Hi, family. My name's Lee Davis, and I'm going to talk about two things, Las Vegas and trophies. There are more folks in the audience that paid me to not talk about Las Vegas, so I'm down to one item, which is trophies. But you would like the Las Vegas story as well. Clearly, as you have listened to the folks speak this afternoon, primarily the students that your son has touched. Clearly, for those students, the photograph on my left is their trophy. We don't always know what trophies look like, where they hang, where they are in your homes, where they are in your hearts. But clearly, for the students that are here today, we know where Mr. Reed is in their heart. The last thing I would like to identify for you, for the family, is that the other kind of trophies that are here. And for just a second, I would ask all of the Pioneer Valley High School students here just to raise your hand and hold it in the air for a few seconds while I explain what I'm doing with the family. For all the Pioneer Valley High School students, please raise your hand. Thank you, family, for taking a look folks, keep your hands in the air, because for the parents, this is truly a pictorial representation of Neil's trophies he'll have forever. Thank you.
This is Neil's father.
Neil was brutal. There was times he was just brutal with his honesty. Tuesday, he was playing Kelly, and the kids were coming to where I live in Hot Springs, Arkansas, having some health issues and such, and he's concerned about me, and I'd always kid him about different things, but he told me for sure everything was going to be all right, because he knew only the good died young, and I had a hell of a chance to make it a while. I think I speak for all of the family. It's pretty much overwhelming. I've been in this business for 35 years, all levels, all parts of the country, and I can speak for all of you that this is, I've never seen anything like it. And I would say this, I would leave with this without one of his funny things, but you have an opportunity now. You know, we're always looking for at things, why are things wrong? Like maybe things aren't as well as going as well as we'd like. He was truly a difference maker. You have a chance to not sit back and let somebody else change the world. You can change the world. You can treat people properly. There's a time when there's some sternness, obviously. There's obviously a great time for some jokes to cajole you, to motivate you. But if you did one thing for Neil, for Kelly, for those kids, emulate him. I heard one of the girls say a while ago, he was my hero as well.
Part of everyone in this room. And we hope that the meaning of today was to bring you some joy. So we thank you.
Real quick, it's not going to be too long, but Reed was my sophomore PE teacher. I was a sophomore last year. I'm going to be a junior this year, and he was more than just a teacher. Like, I don't think anyone in this room can explain it enough. He was, when you thought you couldn't take it anymore, when you thought you wanted to just give up, he made you. He didn't even let you think about it. He pushed you. He physically would make you do everything you can. And I remember one specific day, we were playing basketball, because everyone knows how much he loves basketball too. We were playing basketball, and I dislocated my pinky, and I was freaking out because my bone was like sticking out. And he's like, calm down, don't cry, just go fix it with the nurse. I went, got it popped right back in. When I come back, they're running laps. And I look at him, and I have my packet of ice around my pinky. It was fat, like my thumb. And I kind of just sit there, and I start sitting down, and he looks at me, and he goes, what are you doing? And I'm like, what do you mean, what am I doing? I'm sitting down, coach. Look at my pinky, it's like my thumb. He's like, it's not your leg, is it? And I'm like, coach, it was my bone. It was out of my socket, you saw. He's like, that's fine. He's like, get up and go run. He's like, girl, you don't think you're gonna like just sit there, are you? So I get up with my ice pack in one hand and my messed up pinky in the other. There I am, like running all dumb to the side of the fence and run back. He's like, that wasn't so hard, was it? And I said, no, it hurt though. He's like, there's a lot of things in life that are gonna hurt you. You gotta push yourself. You gotta keep running. And he looked at me in the eyes, he's like, I don't care how much you hurt sometimes. You gotta pick yourself up and you gotta go. That's the kind of man he was. And my mom told me, because my pinky to this day is still messed up. My mom told me, she's like, let's go to the doctor so they can break it and fix it, like, once and for all. And I said, no. I refuse. I know it sounds dumb, but I refuse to fix that pinky because every time I look at that pinky, like, I think of him and what he taught me. I have never had a teacher like that that when I was hurt still made me run. Like, who does that? But I can honestly say we all love that man a lot. And I don't understand why God does some things. I don't understand why God would take people out of our lives like that. But I can promise you it's for a reason. And it seems so unfair. But I've been there. And I promise you, it will get better. But you gotta trust that God has a bigger purpose than just all this pain. And he's gonna help you get through that. And I want you to personally know, the whole family, you guys are in my family's prayers and in this whole school's prayers. This whole school, we'll be praying for your guys' family, because your husband, your son, he meant a lot to this school. And I don't think this school is going to be the same without him. But we're Panthers, and we're going to fight. And we're going to get through this because of what your son and what your husband and your family member taught us. And he's with us. So thank you.
Something that's very uncomfortable for most people, and that is death. We don't enjoy thinking about it. It just usually gets dropped in our lap like this, and then we have to think about it. And when we do, I know there are many times people have questions in their mind about, what would happen to me if I died? What does this, you know, because we can't really understand. We really can't. People have questions. I know and I trust and I believe, I know who has the answers. I know that God has the answers. But we can't. We try to make sense out of things, but we really can't put our finger on it. We never will. But God knows exactly what is going on. It's beyond our understanding. It's too big for us. But as we close here, I want to give you an opportunity. I want you to think about what would happen. Are you really, how do you feel about death? It's very uncomfortable. It's a very hard subject. People don't just talk about it on a daily basis. But on a day like this, where it's right in front of us, you know, I want to ask you, deep down in your heart, you know, where are you with that concerning your relationship with God? And are you ready for that? The Bible teaches us that we can be ready. And I'm not going to get into a long thing about that, but I just want to tell you this, that the Bible does say that we need a Savior. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. And He died on the cross for our sins. And I know that Neil believed in God. I don't know exactly his stance and all that, but we used to joke about it and stuff because Greg gave him a Bible, and I was always telling him, you reading that Bible? And, you know, I would get on about it. But I know that he believed in God, and I don't know how all that works. I can't tell you exactly what happened, and, you know, who knows? He knows. But what about you right now? See, what about you? And I just want to tell you this as we close today, and we are going to go outside if anybody has a candle they want to light. If you don't, that's okay. Maybe we'll just pray out there before we leave. But I want to give you an opportunity right now before we leave this building to think about whether you're ready or willing to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And even if you're not ready today, that's okay. But I want to tell you that one of these days, you're probably going to have to make that choice. And today might not be the day for you. You might not be ready for that today. But the Bible says, now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. You can get saved. The Bible says salvation is as near as the words in your mouth. So I'm going to ask you to, as we close here, to bow your heads with me, if you would, and just think to yourself, and I'm not giving you all the details, but just think to yourself, do I really know the Lord? Am I ready to meet my Maker? And the Bible teaches us that we can be ready. So I'm going to say a prayer. You don't have to say it. And the prayer has no magic in it. It's all about a relationship with God. But I can tell you this, as we're bowing our heads and just in an attitude of prayer, if you're ready to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, He'll come into your heart right now. Because that's what we need. We need a Savior to save us, that we can one day be with Him in the air. So, if you want to, I want you to repeat this prayer with me. That is just a simple prayer of inviting Him to come into your life. Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I know I've made mistakes in my life. But I believe that You died on the cross for my mistakes, for my sins. So I ask You now to forgive me and to cleanse me of all my sins. And I open up my heart and I ask You to come in. be my Lord and Savior. And I thank you now for dying on the cross just for me. Help me to follow you the rest of my life. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time together. Keep the family in the palm of your hand. Keep all these students and colleagues and coaches and friends and everybody here. Just keep their hearts intact and supply your healing, virtue, and everything that's needed. Let the days ahead, let all the needs be met, the finances that need to be supplied, the food, and just everything, Lord God. You know how big this is. And we just trust into your hands. Thank you for the privilege of being able to gather here together to share this special time with loved ones who all have the same love for this wonderful man, Neil Reed. We thank you that you allowed us to be a part of his life. Thank you for sending him here and letting us get connected to him in a special way that kind of connects us all together to one another. Thank you for that privilege and for the privilege of getting to meet his family and know them. And just, I know you're going to take care of them and help them. Thank you for this whole event today. And bless everyone as they go on their way. Amen. Again, I want to remind you that counseling will be available.